So today's speaker is Daeyeon from the Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering Department. And I'm not sure, you said you have two different potential talks.
You guys are so special that I prepared two different presentations. So we can stay here for 2 hours. or you guys can choose, okay? So one topic is this topic here, and I'm not, of course, going to tell you what this topic is about. This is title, and the other one is, let's see, my computer won't work. It's this one. Okay, so I'm going to take a vote here. Who wants this one?
Which one lasts longest?
They're about the same length, so don't worry. So who wants this one? Raise your hand. This one, raise your hand. Okay, see, I think. Alright, so I'll do this one. And then you guys can come back next year, and then I'll do the other one. Okay? Alright, sounds good. So, so how many of you, I should have asked this first, how many of you are legally able to drink beer? Maybe I shouldn't do this. I usually give this talk at bars, okay? And half the people are drunk. And I'm drunk, but I need to talk. So I had a few drinks before I came here, so I'll be okay. Alright, so I'm going to talk about things here, okay? And how I have fun with making bubbles. Alright, so. Is this working? Alright, so. Beer. And I love this definition of beer. Okay. You guys probably know this yet. Because you can't drink beer, right? Yeah. Awesome. So, okay. So, here's a factoid that some of you may know. So, beer is the world's most widely drunk, consumed alcoholic beverage. Okay? It's the most consumed alcoholic beverage. Now, this is the third most popular drink after... What's the first one?
Water.
Okay. So that's good. How about the second one? Okay, so we have Coca-Cola, coffee. Okay, so it's probably coffee if you just count for the people in this country, but this is tea. And this is because of 1.1 billion people in China and another billion in India. Okay, who drink tea. Alright, so beer is number three. And beer is fascinating drink. There are lots of books on beer. So you know, this one is the science of beer, and in fact you can find many, many books on science of beer. Okay? And if you look at the table of contents of these books, you'll often find a chapter on bubbles. Okay? Because bubbles in beer is a very special feature. Okay, that makes this particular drink very special. So if you So you didn't know this, but if you open a bottle of beer and then pour it out in a glass, this is what you get, okay? And this part, what is this called? Good, you don't know. Right, so this is called beer head, right? So these are little tiny bubbles that collect at the top, and they basically, when you see something like this, you immediately know this is beer because of this beer head, right? If this drink didn't have that beer head, you would know that it's beer. Okay, and beer head has lots of functions. Okay, it looks very nice, but it also has other functions. It also, you know, provides the aroma to the drink. Okay, all right. So why does beer have this beer head when you open a fresh bottle of beer and then pour it into a glass? Anybody? By the way, if you have any questions, just stop me and ask me questions. Okay.
Because of the CO2 inside of the beer.
Wonderful. So because of CO2, right? So there's gas dissolved in there. Okay. Now, lots of drinks have CO2 dissolved in the drink. Okay. So for example, champagne also has carbon dioxide dissolved in the drink, but they don't form this beer head, right? If you remember, champagne. Well, I guess you guys didn't know. So Sprite. Okay. Something that you guys may have drunk. You know. When you open the Sprite bottle, it still forms bubbles, but you don't form, you know, what would be equivalent of beer head in Sprite, right? So the fact that there's CO2 in the drink is partially correct. It's partial answer to this question, why does beer form this beer head? So let me show you why. So there's CO2 dissolved in the liquid, okay? And what happens is, so this is the solubility curve, okay, for different gases in water. Okay, so what happens is if you increase pressure, of course, more gas dissolves in the liquid. And if you remove the pressure, so decrease pressure, the gas has to leave the liquid, and that's why you form bubbles, right? So when you have a bottle of beer and then you open it, okay, you will hear, right? That's because you're releasing pressure. And when you release pressure, basically these bubbles equally and form, then they leave the solution. So that makes sense. But again, like I said, that doesn't explain why you end up with this beer head. All right, so the reason that you end up with these very stable collection of bubbles, which forms the beer head, is because there are these molecules in beer that is able to stabilize these gas bubbles. Okay, so these are proteins, different types of sugar in the solution that are able to absorb at this gas bubble surface, okay, and then make them stable. So that's what's so different about beer and other carbonated drinks. Okay? Does that make sense? All right, good. Now, there are people that are really serious about beer. Okay, so this is a paper that was published, I guess, a long time ago. How many of you have not been born in this year? How many of you were born this year or were before this year? All of you were born after this year? Oh my God. I shouldn't be talking about beer here. So this is a paper, and what they do is they use MRI imaging to study beer head. Okay? Fascinating, right? And people get PhD in studying beer head using MRI. You know, when I read this paper, I asked a question. Now, if you guys were reading a paper like this, what question would you ask? No question? You don't have any question? Really?
What do they do
with
the beer
anthem? Oh. You're thinking just like me. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. They don't describe it in their paper, so you have to ask the authors. But yeah, I mean, so people are very serious about beer head. Now, I know that you guys don't drink beer, but in case some of you have, some of you may know this particular type of beer. Guinness. And I'll tell you that Guinness is loved by some people because of its smoothness. It feels very smooth when you drink this. Okay? It's got a nice taste to it, but it also is very smooth. So does anyone know why this particular beer feels so smooth? No? Okay. So instead of using carbon dioxide, which provides that bite, okay? That you often feel when you drink carbonated drinks like Sprite, Coke, or beer. Guinness uses nitrogen. Okay, so instead of CO2, nitrogen is dissolved in beer. Okay, now there's a problem with nitrogen though. Okay, so the problem is that nitrogen is, like, go back to this curve here. Nitrogen doesn't have high solubility in water. Okay, so it's not very easy to dissolve large amounts of nitrogen in the liquid, so that when you open the bottle, it, you know, creates bubbles and then it forms this nice beer head. Okay. So CO2 is not on this graph, but CO2 would be like something like that. CO2 has enormous solubility in water. Okay. So what do people do? Okay. So Guinness has came up with this method where they put something called widget. Okay, so it's a little thing that goes into the bottle of Guinness. If I play this movie, okay, when you open a bottle of Guinness, what happens is, okay, that's how you form the beer head when you drink Guinness. So basically, instead of dissolving nitrogen gas in the liquid, okay, you basically pressurize nitrogen above the liquid, Okay, so it's nitrogen is now pressurized everywhere, including inside this widget. And when you release the pressure, the gas, nitrogen gas, flows through a little hole here, okay, and making little these tiny bubbles. And then once you form the bubbles, all these molecules that's in the beer will absorb the gas bubbles and then stabilize the gas beer head. Okay, so that's this is exactly the reason why Guinness tastes very smooth. You guys can do that. Okay, any questions? All right. Okay, this is a little factoid that I just discussed. So bite in many carbonate drinks come from CO2, not the bubble itself. Okay, so if you have bubbles of different gases, they're not going to bite like CO2. And that's what I just wanted to tell you. So like my title said, you know, I'm going to talk about three things: beers, bubbles, and beyond. So now I'm going to move on to bubbles. So there are two different types of bubbles. You know, one type of bubble is, you know, if you have these globules of gas, basically gas particles suspended in liquid, these are called liquid bubbles. And of course, you know, as kids, you probably played with gas bubbles, right? You make soap solutions, and then you blow these soap solutions through some rings, and then you get these nice gas bubbles. So today, I'm going to focus most of my attention to liquid bubbles. Okay. Now, the reason that these gas bubbles are so colorful is because of the diffraction or interference that you get, okay? Light interference that you get from the bubble film here. And it happens that the thickness of this film is right around 100 nanometers, okay? So that's the thickness range where it really interacts very well with the visible light, and that's why you get this iridescence in gas bubbles. Okay, so moving on to the liquid bubbles. Okay, can you guys find bubble here? Yes? Where listen to my question, where is bubbles? Anybody? Are you guys all drunk?
In the yellow.
Oh wow, this is the first time that somebody has actually answered this. Okay. This guy, his name is Bubbles. You guys knew that? See? It's good to be speaking to a young generation. Man, I've given this talk about, you know, five times at, you know, bars, and nobody's ever answered this question. They're all like, yeah, I see Bubbles. Okay. So yeah. So Bubbles apparently is the, I think, the fifth or sixth most popular character in finding Nemo. I found the information in Wikipedia, so that's true. Okay, so bubbles. And you know, what's interesting about this guy is that he's always frustrated. Why? Why is Bubbles always frustrated?
I think he wants to keep Bubbles.
Right.
Hidden.
Right. But Bubbles always go someplace or they always disappear, right? So that's the problem that I'll talk about now. Okay? So bubbles are actually used in many different applications. Okay, we marvel at bubbles, and, you know, kids play with bubbles, but bubbles are very important. So if you look here, you can see that there are at least two books dedicated to the topic of bubbles and fluids, right? At least two books. But there are a lot more than two, okay? A lot more than two. Bubbles are used a lot in hospital. Okay, so ultrasound imaging. You guys know what ultrasound imaging is. So, you know, you go to the hospital, you know, if they want to look at, you know, inside you, they'll take a scanner and then, you know, do a scan, right? And what's great about ultrasound imaging is that it's cheap, right? It doesn't cost much, and it's not painful for the patient, right? All they do is they put some gel on you and then, you know, they do the scan. Now, the problem with ultrasound imaging is that it's not very good at, you know, finding little things in your body. Like, if there's a small cancerous tissue, it's not very good at finding it. And that's because the contrast is very poor. Okay, so you have to go to more sophisticated and, of course, more expensive imaging techniques. So what people do is they actually put bubbles into a vein, tiny, tiny bubbles, and that drastically enhances the contrast. And that enables people to, you know, see things they weren't able to see without bubbles. Okay, so bubbles are used as contrast agents. Also, what people do is people now put some drug molecules on the surface of bubbles, and then they use ultrasound to trigger the release of bubbles, not bubbles, of the drug molecules from the bubble. So let's say you have, you know, cancer or something, not you, but somebody has cancer in certain part of their body, right? Now, the current method is you take, you know, chemotherapy, and you know, there are lots of side effects of chemotherapy, and that's because these drugs will attack pretty much any cell, every cell they see, right? So what people are thinking about right now is they're going to use bubbles that has these drug molecules on it, and then they're going to locally trigger the release of these drugs by using ultrasound. Pretty cool, right? I think it's pretty cool. All right, and then this is something that I'm doing in my lab. Yeah?
How did the bubbles make the contrast and the ultrasound image better?
Because it scatters light very well. So our body is mostly water, right? So when you are trying to see something, you're trying to pick things out that's mostly water.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not much contrast. Right. You basically blow bubbles in, okay, that will scatter sound very well. Ultrasound. Any other questions? Right. And this is something that we are trying to do in our lab, which is, let's say you have these tiny, tiny particles, and some of you may work with these particles, nanoparticles, okay? And the question is, how do you, you know, take these particles and then assemble them into really big structure, okay? And an analogy is, you know, if you have a brick, how do you make a building out of it, okay? A good way to make a building out of a brick is to fill the building with lots of air, okay? So that's basically what we are trying to do. So we take these small nanoparticles, put them around bubbles, okay? And then take these particle-covered bubbles and then assemble them into bigger structures. So this is type of research that I do for my students in my lab. Okay? And people, nature has been, you know, using this kind of approach. So this particular approach is called hierarchical assembly. You take something small, you put it into a slightly larger thing, and then you take this slightly larger thing and then put these into really big structure. And nature has been doing this, right? So all these, you know, structures found in bone or these honeycomb that bees make, they have this very poor structure. And what's great about these hierarchical structures is that they're light, yet they have the functionality. Okay, if you also have these very regular structure made out of bubbles, they can have very interesting acoustic properties. Okay, one particular acoustic property that I'm very particularly interested in is this acoustic band gap property. So basically what this is showing here is if you can arrange these very highly monodisperse, meaning that bubbles of exactly the same size in a very regular manner, okay, the propagation of sound can be blocked. So this is the frequency of sound, and you can see that sound propagation can be blocked. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that you can create materials that will completely block the propagation of sound. So think about having wallpaper, okay, so it's paper thin literally, that can completely block the propagation of sound by arranging bubbles, these very regular bubbles in very, very regular arrays like this. Okay? This is the type of things that we can do if we are able to make these very monodisperse bubbles and then arrange them into these regular arrays. Any questions? Okay. Good. So let me show you another example of how bubbles are used in industry. And let's see. I don't know if you can hear this. Does this have? It doesn't. It's okay. Let's play this and let's see if you can hear this.
One of the products that I work on, a very unique product, are glass microscopes, glass bubbles. Here's a sample of what I'm talking about. The white powder in this tube is a glass bubble that is about 20 microns in size, and it's very free-flowing. If you looked at these under the microscope, you would see these small spherical objects that is hollow inside. You might ask, what are these useful for? These are low in density, between 0.1 and 0.6 grams per cc in density. So you can put these into plastic resin systems and make very lightweight composite systems. Here's an example of expanded polystyrene foam that's used a chemical blowing agent probably to make this foam structure. Notice it's very friable. You can break it very easily. here's a sample of glass bubble containing composite in polypropylene. So it's light in weight, but as you can see, it's very stiff, and it can be used for structural applications such as automotive parts, aerospace parts, and other types of structural parts.
So this is a product that's commercialized by 3M, and I actually got to meet Steve last week. I was at 3M, and it's kind of fun to, you know, meet with him and talk to him about this video. But these are the bubbles that they sell. It's a glass particle, but it's hollow, so that's why they call them bubbles. And they use them as fillers in composites. Okay. And what's great about this is, you know, he had this demonstration where he breaks polystyrene foam and then tries to break foam that has these bubbles, right? These bubbles are very stiff, they're very strong, but they're very light. So you can actually make a material lighter and stronger by using these types of bubbles. Okay? Pretty cool, I think. Let's see. All right, so let me talk to you about how people typically make bubbles, okay? So what people do typically is, so let's say you have a cup of water, and now I'm going to place a drop of oil, but you don't have to worry about it. But basically what people will typically do is they'll just shake it, and then they'll form bubbles like this, okay? But for many, many applications, having bubbles that have very broad size distribution, meaning that, you know, bubbles have all bubbles here in this picture have all different sizes, right? This can be disadvantageous for many different reasons. Number one, when people inject bubbles, right, into people to do contrast ultrasound imaging, you don't want bubbles that are larger than 2 microns. It causes embolism. Okay, it's not good. That's not what you want to have in your body. Okay, and believe it or not, the bubbles that people use for ultrasound imaging currently uses shaking method to make bubbles. Okay, so that's not good. Another reason that this type of bubbles is not good is because if the size is very broad, size distribution is very broad, you cannot use these bubbles to make those very interesting structures that have interesting acoustic properties. Okay, you cannot make those acoustic bandgap materials. In order to make those acoustic bandgap materials, your bubbles has to be all exactly the same size. Okay? And also, when you make bubbles like this, this is the problem that bubbles has, right? Bubbles disappear. They don't stick around, they'll dissolve. Okay, so you got these problems, and I'm going to show you how we solve these problems in our lab. Okay, so this is what I just talked about. So bubbles, their size is all over the place, and also because of something called Laplace pressure, which some of you may know, gas will dissolve. Okay, we know that, and they don't stick around. So it's very difficult to use these gas bubbles as materials, okay? But I'm going to show you how we use them as materials in our lab. So let me first tell you about how we solve the polydispersity issue. Okay, and we get our inspiration from a leaky faucet, which many of you probably have seen at some point in your life. So if I play this movie, okay, so you've seen something like this before, right? What's remarkable is, let me play this one more time. If you collect every single droplet here, okay, and then compare their weight, they're almost exactly the same, always. Okay, so next time, if you're at home, you know, if you're bored, and you see a leaky faucet, collect the droplets, and then, you know, compare their weight. Seriously. Does anyone know why this is the case?
A certain amount of weight, the water will be heavier than the surface tension.
Awesome. This is great. So this is what it looks like, okay? So what was your name?
Michael.
Michael? Okay. So Michael nailed it. So when the water drop starts to form, okay, it doesn't fall right away. And the reason for that is because there's something called surface tension that holds the water droplet at the tip of this faucet, right? Okay. Now, at some point it gets really large because water is being kept steady, the water keeps flowing into that droplet, and when it gets really large, what happens? Gravity pulls it down, right? So when gravity takes over, there's balance between gravitational force and surface tension force that determines the size of this droplet. Last time I checked, gravity doesn't change very well. Okay? And surface tension of water really doesn't change. The size of this droplet will always be the same. Okay? So if we can use this concept of balancing forces, we might be able to make bubbles that are very, very monodisperse. Okay? So here's how we make our faucet in our lab. Okay, it's very simple. So we take a glass capillary, okay, so that's a round glass tube, that's about a millimeter in diameter. Okay, and then we heat it, and then we pull it like this. So when we pull it, we get this orifice. Okay? And then we slide this into a square capillary. When we do this, the inner dimension of the square capillary is 1 millimeter. Okay, so the outer diameter of this fits the inner dimension of the square capillary. So if you look at it from the side, it looks like that. So we have red and blue. So you can, what the consequence of this is that you can flow two different types of fluids or liquids from one side, one through red, one through blue. That make sense? Okay. And then this is the faucet that we make. And what do you mean that this is a faucet? I'll show you what. Since you guys are being so nice, I'll show you bathroom movies. This is what I tell my kids. Since you guys are nice, I'm going to show you movies. Okay. So that's my faucet, right? So that's my capillary, and that's my square capillary. I have two fluids flowing from one side, so one through the gray, one through the blue in this case. And if I play this movie here, you'll see bubbles forming, and they're all exactly the same size. Right? Can you guys guess how many bubbles I'm forming here in 1 second? Per second? Guess, come on.
Two?
Okay, good guess. We make about 5,000 bubbles per second. Okay, so this
trick question.
Okay, so this is taken with high-speed camera. So as you can see here, we have balance between surface tension force, which tries to heat the bubble at the tip of the orifice, and then we have something called viscous force. Okay, so for those of you who've taken fluid mechanics, viscous force is fluid flowing around this round object and applying this drag force. Okay. And when the two forces match, you end up with these nice bubbles. Okay? We can take the same faucet and then do something slightly different, which is we flow the fluids from the two opposite ends of the square channel. Okay? So this is the drag force, that's the surface tension force, and that determines the size of the droplet. So when we have the gas flowing from this side and the water flowing from the opposite side, we end up with bubbles forming into this orifice like that. Okay. Again, they're all exactly on the same side. Okay? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty simple, right? It's very simple. So let me tell you how we solve the dissolution issue. So we solve the polydispersity issue. So bubbles dissolve. Now, apparently you can buy, I think this is like $500,000 or something. So this is somewhere in that you can buy. If you have $500,000 that you can spare. Okay? And I don't know, these two gentlemen have some serious look on their face. I think they're about to go underwater for the first time in this day. But they'll be okay. Okay? They'll be okay because this bubble won't dissolve. Why won't it dissolve? When it undergoes when it goes underwater.
It's glass.
Because it's glass. It's got very, very rigid shell around it. Right? So if you can put a very rigid shell around the bubble, that should keep the bubbles from dissolving. Very simple, right? Nothing special about it. So that's exactly what we do. So we make bubbles. So when we make our bubbles, we put a layer of oil around it. Okay? And then in that oil, we dissolve polymer, a particle, whatever. Okay? And then we get rid of the oil, which leaves that polymer, and which forms this very, very stiff shell around the bubble. Okay, I think I have a movie. So again, so these bubbles that we form here, about 5,000 bubbles per second, they're all of the same size. And you can see there's something coming in here. So that's a toluene, which is solvent, that has a polymer dissolvent. Okay, so every single bubble has a oil shell, and in that oil shell we have a polymer dissolvent. Okay? And then we can easily get rid of the polyamine because it's very volatile, and then we end up with these bubbles that have this very stiff polymer shell. Okay? And sometimes we get these, you know, crumpled shells, sometimes we get nice shells, and we can control, you know, when we get these versus these collapsed bubbles. So I'm going to skip to these four slides. So these bubbles, you know, will last forever, essentially. Okay? We can make the bubbles. This is when we make the bubbles initially, and this is after 1 month. And we have some bubbles that's been sitting in the lab as long as I've been here. I've been here 4.5 years, and we have the bubbles that's been sitting in the lab for 4.5 years, and they look exactly the same. Nothing has changed about these bubbles. And again, it's because of those that stiff shell, right? That keeps the bubble from dissolving. Okay. And we can also put lots of different interesting materials into the shell. Okay, so we can put dyes in them, we can put nanoparticles, we can put magnetic particles, so that we can impart functionality to these bubbles. Now, the reason that it was important for us to demonstrate that we can put dyes into the shell is because lots of dyes have very similar structure to anti-cancer agents. They're very hydrophobic, so they don't like to dissolve in water. Okay? So this particular dye has very similar structure to anti-cancer agents called Paxil. Okay, so this means that we can now load these bubbles with anti-cancer agents and then do what I showed you several slides ago, where we use ultrasound to trigger the release, okay, for cancer treatment. This is, you know, again, having some fun with bubbles. So, you know, we put some magnetic particles in bubbles, and then we put a magnet. I think we put a magnet here, okay? And then you see bubbles being dragged. They're very monodispersed. Okay, so you know, you can see them organizing into this very nice arrays. Again, I think, and then you put a click here, right, bubbles. Lots of fun. This is what students get to do in my lab. Play with bubbles. I think that's a pretty good deal. This really surprised me. So we can even dry our bubbles, okay, on surface. Well, why are you laughing? Oh man! Some of you may not know this movie here, Diamonds Are Forever. That's a movie. I didn't make a comment on that because that makes me like look really old. But I'm glad that you mentioned it. I think it was like 60s, 70s, or it's old.
I don't know.
Old movie. Anyway, so we can dry our bubbles on the surface, okay? And then if you place a drop of water, okay, these bubbles come alive. This is pretty remarkable. The reason that this is remarkable is if your product, okay, let's say you're a supplier of bubbles, some product that has bubbles in it, okay? You never just sell bubbles to your customer. You sell the liquid, okay? And that's very heavy, okay? If you want to move liquid from point A to point B, that's very, very heavy, okay? And that's very energy intensive labor to move liquid around. This means that we can now fully dry our bubbles, right? And then sell the powder to the customer. And all the customer has to do is add water, okay, to get their bubble product to work. I can see this movie forever. I'm not get bored. Okay. So this is what I get to do, okay? So I literally make a living out of making bubbles. Okay, so that's me. And this has another positive impact, which is when I go home, okay, I go to tell my kids. So this is a couple years ago. So she's gonna turn 7 and he's gonna turn 4 next month. They think I go to work to make bubbles. So my daughter, who's now gonna turn 7, like I said, she wants to become a chemical engineer. Her making bubbles is daddy's job. Okay. Now the beyond part. So we can now take these bubbles that have nanoparticle shells, okay? I talked about this hierarchical assembly idea. So we can take those bubbles and then assemble those into bigger structures. So if you look at the scale bars here, so this is half a millimeter. So every single bubble here has particles that's about 20 nanometers, okay? So we take 20 nanometer particles and then assemble them into bubbles that are about 50 microns, and then we take those 50 micron bubbles and then assemble them into a much, much larger structure, which have very interesting properties. Okay, so this structure, for example, is very light and has the mechanical property that is very similar to glass. Okay. All right, I think that's all. That's all I got. So that's my food. And I'll take any questions you guys might have. Thank you. you guys want to listen to the second talk? Next year.
Next year.
I got lots of movies there also. I'll do that next year. Yeah?
How do the bubbles cancel out sound? How does a layer of bubbles do?
So what happens is, it's very much like light interference. So you have two things happening. Bubbles are absorbing the sound, okay? And then light gets reflected, and then there's layers of reflected light that cancel each other out.
Yeah.
So that's how it
happens. Okay. So like sound waves, yeah.
Exactly. Exactly. So sound waves cancels itself out when it interacts with this particular resonance function.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
How are you arranging the bubbles into the higher order structures?
You need to come work with me now. It's very easy, actually. So if we look at... these structures, for example, here, okay? Because they are so regular, it's actually energetically more favorable for these bubbles to pack into ordered structure. Because they're so regular. So if you take, you know, billiard ball, and then, you know, or mark, you see the thing that tilts, right, in the lobby here. If you look at it, things want to pack into regular array. And that's because marbles are very, very monodispersed. If you put marbles that are polydispersed, they can't do that. So the fact that they're all of the exact same size favors that process. Okay. Yeah?
So how do they pack into a hollow sphere then?
Hollow sphere?
In the larger structure.
So let's see. Let's go to here.
Are those hollow?
So these are hollow. So that used to be a bubble. Okay, so every single hollow structure here used to be a bubble, and bubble has small particle in the shell.
So how do they form a something that's a shell as opposed to just a very tightly packed tessellation of a crystal?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's see. So it's this process here. So when we form our bubble, we wrap it with a thin layer of oil, and then in that layer we put particles. Yeah?
When you remove the oil, why don't the particles you put in the oil leave? Why do they stay on?
Yeah, that's a good question. So why do particles stay here, right, between air and water? So apparently, when you have a particle, okay, and you stick it between two immiscible fluids, in this case air and water, it wants to stay there. And the reason for that is, so water and air hate each other, right? So by placing the particle here, you reduce the surface area between air and water. So energetically, when a particle gets to the interface, it doesn't want to leave, because it wants to minimize the area between these two things. Very good question. No more questions? Okay, go enjoy your beer. Go on. All right. Thanks, guys.